am Dee Stevens. I'm executive director here at the Hayward Area Historical Society. And on behalf of the board and members of my staff, I'd like to welcome you to Hayward, California, if you're coming here for a visit. And those of you who are residents and patrons, welcome to the Historical Society. Just to remind you that this place, this gallery that you're sitting in, is called the Community Gallery. And it's a gallery that's self-curated, which means that you, as members of our community, as people who live here or work in Hayward, in the greater Hayward area, Castro Valley, Cherryland, San Lorenzo, and other unincorporated parts of our little corner of the East Bay, are welcome to have your event, your program, your exhibition here. This is a space that we like to say is our, not to cast aspersions on our cafe, but this is really the kitchen table. And this is where people really come to pose their questions, to talk to each other, and of course, to show off the best that they are. So to all of you, there's an invitation, and of course, welcome to participate with us when you can. This Black History program is the eighth that we've had here, and we do this program every year with some people that we're very proud of. The Links Incorporated, the Eden Rose chapter here in this area, and also the Palma Ceia Baptist Church. And together, the three of us are partners in talking about issues that are relevant to all of our communities, not just the African-American community, and to be able to do it not just in February, but at other times during the year. So it's an important time, of course, with the new president, a new change of direction, perhaps, as we're looking at where we are and where we go over the next few years. And I think the topic today is going to be a very timely one for all of us, not just for our presenter, but all of us who will be listening to him today. By all means, if you have questions, save them. There'll be opportunities for you to be part of the conversation about the crisis of Black education. And at this moment, I'm happy just to say there are refreshments in the back, so help yourself when there's a break. Be attentive, because I think you'll hear things you may not know, but or need to be reminded of. And finally, there are evaluations in the back, and I hope you'll take a moment at the end of the program today to just tell us what we can do better. Nothing's perfect, as much as we try to be, but we do a pretty darn good job. So thank you all for being here today. I'd like to introduce the Women's Ministry President, Deborah Vanwell Huff.
And I just want to welcome you to another program here at the Hayward Area Historical Society, along with the Eden Rose Links chapter. Palma Ceia has been involved with this for several years now, and for a couple of years we held it at our church. And the most memorable one for me was with Regina Mason. She wrote the book, The Life of William Rhymes. And it told about her three great-great-grandfathers and his struggle during slavery and how he became free. And if you have a chance, it is now a short film, and most of the film festivals are now holding it. So if you have a chance, go and see it. But I just want to say welcome, and if you're looking for a church home, Palma Ceia Baptist Church is at 28605 Bruce Grove in the city of Hayward. Thank you, and enjoy the program.
Rose chapter is our partner in this, and so I'd like to invite their president up to say a few words.
Thank you very much. I'm Dolores Ward, president of E.B. Rose Chapter. I would like our members who are seated in the audience, as well as in the back, taking care of some of the signing sheets, to just please stand. Please stand. Be recognized. There you go. Thank you very much. Thank you. Indeed, we have been involved in this program, attempting to bring history, particularly Black history, alive here in Hayward. This is our eighth year of the partnership, and it has been an absolutely delightful partnership, because I think that this is certainly one of the ways that we serve our community, and that's what we are. We are a service organization linked in friendship. Linked in friendship, and indeed we are friends. So again, to make this welcome very, very short and brief, because we certainly want to get to Dr. James L. Taylor. And you know, this is an encore. I was going to say performance for you. And this is an encore presentation, because he was with us last year, and such an exciting presenter. We certainly were overjoyed to have the opportunity to ask him to return, and he has. So again, greetings on behalf of our chapter. Thank you very much for being here. Thank you.
And without much more overflow, let me introduce our speaker today. James Lance Taylor is professor and director of the African American Studies Program at the University of San Francisco. You have probably seen him quite often the last few months as a commentator on the elections and the political climate of our community. And so we're delighted that Channel 2 has let him off the hook for a little while so he can be with us today. Professor Taylor was also at two of our local high schools yesterday, and I appreciate him going both to Hayward High School and Tennyson to speak with the students there about this same topic. So there they got sort of the hors d'oeuvre version of his talk today, and Professor Taylor is going to give us a little more for the grown-ups. Professor Taylor, welcome again.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Thank you. So I'd appreciate it if you all can give me a heads up at about 20 minutes in so I can begin to wind down, because I can get caught up and we'll lose track of time. I'm so glad to see so many young people here today. I have points to make to the adults, but I also hope to speak to some of the young people here as a professor and as an educator and somebody who comes from the bottom. I'd like to acknowledge from back in Long Island, New York, where I was raised by my mother alone. It was her, and she raised about basically nine of us on a $14,000 income in the projects in Long Island, New York. I was number six of seven children. Then we had two early nieces and nephews. Now there's about 50 of us. My mother is 92 years old and is now convalescent, but she is one of those women that you all know of in our legacy and in your own families. Those pioneers, those giants whose shoulders we stand on. And the strength that I have is my mother's strength. It always has been. The only reason why I went to pursue an education beyond the streets was to give my mother something to be proud of. It became important to me after a while, living in my community, when my brothers and sisters got caught up in legal issues and drug issues and other kind of issues, to try to be at least an alternative for my mother so that when she walked in public, she could have dignity in public. No matter what else was going on in her family, she could always point to this one son who at least seemed like he had his stuff together. I didn't have it together, but I was trying and I was hustling and I was grinding. And if it turned out that things resulted in a good outcome, then more power to me. But my whole motivation, I'm trying to be clear, for my education was to be a good son to my mother. That was the only motivation I had. I was not interested in academics and education for education's sake. I just wanted my mother to be empowered by her son's life. And when she walked in the supermarket, because I used to have to drive her all the time, and she would talk to everybody in the supermarket, And so I figured I'd give her something good to talk about, because sometimes my brothers and sisters, and I'm not putting them down, would have things happen in their lives that my mother would often have to be ashamed of in public. And the one thing she was always able to do, now that she's now suffering dementia, but when she was, you know, clear in her mind, she was able to point to her son in California. And everybody else knew she had that son out there in California. Now, you all have heard the song, you know, Mother Loves, you know, it's a family affair. My mother loves my brothers and sisters as much as she loves me and sees their accomplishments in every way that she sees my own. And I respect that. That's the power that mothers have and the ability that they have to love all their children and love them differently and uniquely. And that's part of what I want to talk about here today to you here in Hayward. About some of the things we can do in light of the realities we face. The overarching message I want to offer to you all is that we need local solutions for the reality that has emerged on the national level of American politics. I think the future of whatever we do, it has to be at the local level. It has to be democratic, meaning shared voices. And I think it has to be concerted with an understanding that there's been a trend in conservative politics toward localism and giving local leaders, local educators power anyway. And even though they don't have good intentions with what they're about to do, I think you take what the devil gives you and make chitlins into something worth eating. And that's what I'm talking about. They're gonna give us chitlins. And the beauty of our culture and our heritage is we know what to do with chitlins. I'm saying to you, and I hope I don't sound ethnocentric here, that the African-American experience is the one experience in America that is ready for Donald Trump or anybody else like him, because we've been here before. We've seen 10,000 Donald Trumps throughout our history at the local level. He's new to America at the national level, but we know him. He's a familiar spirit. We've known him all of our existence in this country. So he might be new for some folk, but for the heritage of the African-American people, as such, they have seen this demon before, and they've dealt with it and survived it, and they will survive it again. But I think one of the things we have to do is not think in the abstract. I think we need to think concretely about specific things that we can do and can write down on paper. Forget ending racism. That's been everybody's waste of time. Forget bringing social justice. Forget ending sexism. These things are too vague to get anything done with, because you're sitting here taking a little rifle trying to shoot the whole planet. You can't win that way. You have to realize what your target is, and I think realize that you pitch your efforts at the level where you think you can be most successful. I think the mistake we make is we try to solve a big problem with a ill-formed method and solution, and then we end up frustrated. And I try to tell my students all the time, don't waste the next 30 years of your life trying to end racism. You will be 50 and frustrated. Go change something at the local level, or change some policy that you can say, I didn't end racism, but I made sure that they got wheelchair access to this building while I was a student here. See, that student walks away much more powerful than the student who spent 2 years at school trying to end racism, and your granddaddy couldn't end it. So what I'm suggesting to you is practical solutions. As a people, in light of the national reality, the best thing to do, and you here in Hayward are most well positioned, because you have a unique community here, and I think you have resources, and in terms of the heritage and the history I'm reading about up on the hill, in the 50s and 60s and 70s, there's a pre-existing community here, I'm saying, that if you pull your efforts together through the schools and through the leadership, you can truly transform and create a pilot example for other school districts and communities to follow. We need, what the Black Panther Party understood and did so effectively, both in Chicago and here, was they knew that the people just needed examples. They were just trying to demonstrate what can be done, what is possible. That's what Fred Hampton was talking about in Chicago when they were talking about feeding the kids and meeting their needs and testing them for sickle cell. They were trying to be an example so that if they were successful, other people in the audience would say, well, if the Panthers are doing that, we can do that. And what I'm saying to you black folk and our, and everybody else in this room is we need to reinvigorate, or we need to invigorate or bring alive, as you are doing here today, black civil society. And what I mean by black civil society is simply we ain't worried about what the government is doing or what it's going to do. We're going to take care of our community ourselves the best we can. Civil society means wake up the churches, mobilize the churches. Civil society means mobilize the Greeks and the sororities and fraternities. Civil society means mobilizing all the lawyers and the doctors and the engineers and the scientists in our community. Black civil society is that part that takes care of the black common good that has nothing to do with tax dollars. In other words, it's the community meeting the community's needs based on its existing institutions. And the most vibrant institution we've had for the past 150 to 60 years has been the African American church. And I'm so glad that one of the church here, it's Palma Ceia, right? Baptist Church is one of the major leaders here, and I think that is so important because it's so easy for black folk to put down their churches. And black folk are so quick to put down their ministers. We are. Y'all can get hushed, you can get quiet if you want to, and I don't know nothing about what's going on out here, so I ain't in nobody's business. I'm talking about, from my experience across this country, that it is almost default that we kind of like to tear those people who are trying to lead us as best they can down, because we don't have nothing better to do. I think we need to lift our people up. If people are trying to lead, even with their shortcomings, try to lift them up and meet them where they are. Take them out to lunch and say, brother, what you said last week was just so far off, I brought you to dinner to tell you about it. And correct each other. What I'm suggesting is not that we abdicate our responsibilities as tax-paying citizens, because we pay taxes, and the rest of this country acts like we don't pay taxes. We are taxpayers, so we have an expectation that the government will do what it's supposed to do. But in the meantime, I think African Americans need to stop looking at the dominant majority group, the Anglo group, the Euro group, as our measure, and begin to look more at other large minority populations in this country who are effectively carrying out what I'm talking about. Every Friday night, those who are observant Jews from Friday night until Saturday, they ain't got nothing to do with you. They don't want nothing to do with you. And nothing to do with the outside world. They're going to come together, they're going to pray, they're going to read Torah, they're going to break the manischewitz bread and wine, and then they're going to pray a little bit more, and the grandmother's there, the grandfather's there, the great-grandmother's there, the great-grandfather's there, the father's there, the mother's there, the auntie's there, the cousins are there, the kids are there, every Friday for your whole life. And I hope this doesn't come out in any kind of anti-Semitic way, but in terms of the overrepresentation of American Jews in certain professions compared to their population, they way outperform their numbers. And I'm saying there's something to this reiteration of community on Friday. I hope I don't sound like I'm being discriminatory, but there's something on Friday that they get that re-ups them and strengthens them to deal with the world and reminds them of who they are on a daily basis and weekly basis as they go forth in their life. And if you got to see your grandparents and your grandmama and your great-grandmama every Friday, I just doubt you're gonna be all thugged out. I just think a whole lot of the things that we've allowed unchecked would be checked. That's right. If we, as a community, recovered our consciousness that we used to have, that integration, don't be offended, I think erased in us. Some of us were so happy to get into the white world that we decided to hell with our institutions, our churches, the talented people leaving, abandoning our communities, and yet being willing to go help everybody and everything else. I'm saying we've come to a point as a people, in light of the emergence of both Barack Obama and Donald Trump in the aftermath, where I don't think national solutions are viable for us. I think this future of black politics and black development, I think integration underdeveloped us. And I think integration was an issue of underdevelopment. I'm not being ideological here. I'm simply saying that we abandon our own institutions, not all of us, obviously, you're here in them. But as a culture, as a people, many of us, I think, catapulted out of community obligations and into individual success that came with the breakthrough. See, what happens in the civil rights movement, what most people don't know, the outcome of the civil rights movement is this. Not black and white joining hands like this. That did not happen. We're more apartheid now than ever. But what happened actually was the division between black haves and black have-nots expanded more sharply, more severely. 40% black middle class went up as a result of I Have a Dream, and the 30% in the hood just went plat. That's what happened as a result of civil rights. The black middle class went up nice and smooth, and the black bottom fell out. And now you're trying to figure out why they're wearing their pants down to their kneecaps. Because that's where they are now, they're down here. They know, you know, a few years ago, I was complaining they were back here. And I thought I was an old fogey then, but now they're down here with belts around them. I don't know how you do it, but I think it has something to do. Maybe they can teach me, but I think it has something to do with why in the 70s we used to get away from the police and why now they can't. Get over that fence. Them Lee jeans. Let me get back on point. But I do want to say, I talked yesterday at Haywood High School in Tennyson, as it was mentioned, and I really went there with a message to try to elevate these young people and motivate them, to help them understand that what America is experiencing is a temporary backlash that I think is similar to what we saw in the 90s and the 80s under Botha in South Africa, when South Africa's apartheid regime lashed out one last time before it died. It went crazy one more time, trying to prove that it was still in power, lashing. And that's what we saw happen in November. This thing is already done. The Browning of America was done 15 years ago. And they now know, I'm talking about the government has read the census, they've told us. Here's what the government has told us. In the next 39 years, the black population of America goes from 45 million to 75 million. Now just sit on that. Think about 75 million black Americans. By the time you reach my age, in about 30 plus years from now, the American population is expected to go from 300 million now to 400 million. Our share of it is that we become from 45 to 75. We get about 35 million more black Americans. The fastest growing group out of everybody are South Asians from India, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, places like Pakistan, Afghanistan. Obviously, Latinos in every county in America, including in lily white counties like Vermont, and New Hampshire, South Dakota, North Dakota, Latinas are outbirthing white women in every county in America. Yep. The Asian population is doubling from 3% to 6%. So whatever you've seen all your life, it'll be twice as much. Every group in America is growing except one. A wall ain't gonna do it. Because it's the bedroom, I'm sorry, I'm trying to be respectful, but it's the bedroom that's causing these issues. Because this is about birth rates and actuaries, about death rates and birth rates, not people coming across the wall and the border. And please be clear, for the last 5 to 7 years, the net number of Mexicans coming across the American border has declined. They ain't coming here. It's not them. It's not Mexicans coming across the border. It's others from Salvador, Nicaragua, Venezuela, other countries that are being driven out by desperation because of regional policies affecting people. So what I want to suggest is that there is a new reality in America. The Browning of America is already set. It's done. It's too late to stop it. A wall can't stop it. All they're going to do is trap themselves behind the wall with us. And when have you known, those of you who are over, say, 55, 65 years old, 60 years old, I don't want to age anybody, but just think about it. When have you known a wall to be a symbol of freedom? When has a wall been a good thing for America? The Berlin Wall. I know the Great Wall of China has a different purpose, but the Great Wall of China, walls, the Iron Curtain, when Churchill talks about Stalin with the Iron Curtain, as a metaphor. And these people think they're getting freedom by building a wall? For folk that are using drones and submarines? Are you kidding me? This is Flintstone stuff. They're sitting here building Flintstone walls, and these people are looking at through the wall with radars. This is some hillbilly cowboy backwoods stuff. And it's making them feel better again. And what I'm suggesting is, as a people, and when I say that, I mean that in general, I think it's important that we try to get hold of what we can control. Do what we can do. Change the lives we can change. I think it's so important that you get specific, enumerable, fancy word, victories. I think you need small victories that you can refer to and say, we got that done, we got that done, we got that done, as opposed to getting all of this done. Small victories build confidence, and that will build the drive to knock down big, big challenges. And that's what I think we as a people have to do here at the local level in Hayward, and in the East Bay and in Northern California and in this country, is I think the future for black politics is local politics, as it always has been. That ain't nothing new. What were the Panthers trying to do in the beginning? Deal with a stop sign or a stop sign in the West Oakland because a girl got run over by a car, I heard, back in the day. What was King trying to do? King wasn't trying to go become some great leader. King was saying, we just need to fix the seat arrangements on this bus. That's all King's interest was fixing the bus seats arrangements. He had no interest in integration, zero, and died regretting integration. Because of its effects on us as a people, not that we didn't want access to wealth and power and capital and fairness, but the tendency of people to focus on their own individual breakthrough, I think, overwhelmed the overarching moment of breakthrough. And as a consequence, we can point to now 20,000 people who are as talented as Thurgood Marshall. Think about that. We got 20,000 Thurgoods now. He wouldn't even be special today. He'd just be another black lawyer. Engineers. I mean, we have one Thurgood Marshall who could do all that he did. Now we got 10,000, and we don't have a way forward with our lawyers. Our lawyers should be leading us. Our lawyers should be making ridiculous changes. I think the Congressional Black Caucus has completely sold out. I think those people ought to lose their dignity and act a fool and go in public and embarrass themselves the way the white folk did with the Tea Party meetings when they had these meetings and they acted completely crazy, and Donald Trump would not have been the most outrageous in those Tea Party gatherings in 2010. In 2010, everybody was acting like Donald Trump. Everybody done forgot. Donald Trump said, oh man, this is working. Oh my God. Hey, where's this black dude's birth certificate, by the way? And then just ran all the way into the White House with it. In fact, I argue that Barack Obama's presidency was a two-year presidency out of the eight years he was in the White House. I argue that Obama was really president from January 09 until November 10. Because the Tea Party backlash, before that, Barack Obama was the most aggressive president in terms of policy in American history, more than FDR and LBJ. The first 100 days were the most aggressive in American history. And then the Tea Party reaction. People had a million gun rally out in Arlington, Virginia that we've all forgotten about. And this is, take back our country. He's not one of us. He's a terrorist. There's nothing that everybody hadn't been saying that Donald Trump is now saying. So I'm telling my students, I'm done demonizing Donald Trump. He is a reflection. He's the mirror. He ain't cause, he's effect. I argue that America, the electors that did show up, see, 100 million people didn't vote, so you can't say America has turned to a racist country all of a sudden. But 60 million of them did. And I believe, I hope I'm wrong, but the way I interpret the November elections is that it was a turn toward apartheid. As much as I said it's a dying thing, I think it's lashing out is to put these white supremacists like Ed Bannon in the Oval Office and in the White House staff vulgarly. They ain't even hiding it. These are white supremacists. These ain't no white folk that want more for whites. In fact, the data show, when you look at who voted for Hillary, the poor white folk went with Hillary as much as they did Trump. Hillary actually, in the exit polls, won the economic argument. So the exit polls showed that the people who voted for Donald Trump, their average household income was $75,000. That ain't Jerry Springer's crowd. That ain't poor white trash, so-called. That is not poor white. That's a whole lot of everything. Donald Trump won everything. And what we forget is if Obama was voted for in 08 and 12 by whites alone, Obama would have lost both times. Both times. And I think it's really important to understand the reality that what the electorate seemed to me to do was to turn back toward apartheid, a racial separateness. See, we're Christian, Protestant, and Catholic, and Muslim, and everything in between. We tend to be good-natured and give most people the benefit of the doubt that they will do right by other human beings, because we generally do right by other human beings. Even when they shoot us up in a church on a Sunday, we'll forgive them before the blood dries. Right. I ain't never seen that kind of thing go back the other way. I've never seen a cop killer in Dallas, for example, be forgiven. But our genuflection, I think because of our deep cultural roots, is the tendency to forgive and to reach out. And what I'm suggesting is that we are at a point where we have to have no permanent friends, no permanent enemies, but just permanent interests. And what I mean by that is at this point, we have to be able and willing to do whatever we have to at the local level. Here, in terms of the school board, in terms of the Board of Education, in terms of the operations of the schools, I don't know it as well. You all do. You all know the names. You know people. You know who they are. You know what's going on here at Tennyson and at Hayward and in the community in general. And so I'm saying to you, especially those of you who are veteran activists, I think our young people need some mentoring and advice on how to negotiate this moment that they're dealing with. They're going to do it. They're going to lead it. But King always listened to Howard Thurman. See, Howard Thurman, you all know Howard Thurman over there in San Francisco? Howard Thurman was King's main advisor, but he never got out and marched with him. He stayed behind and he gave King all kinds of advice. When King died, he had Howard Thurman's book, Jesus and the Disinherited, in his pocket, King did, by Howard Thurman, great pastor over in San Francisco. The first interracial church ever in America was over in San Francisco under Howard Thurman, a former dean of Howard University School of Theology, came out here to, and he and his wife Sue Bailey Thurman were very influential in the Bay Area. But again, what I'm suggesting is that those of you who may feel like you aren't going back out there to fight anymore, you can reach out to these young people and give them advice. I think a lot of what's going on, we haven't, a lot, you know, the young people are having to reinvent the wheel a lot in some of these actions. And I think they have to be sort of advised as to what has happened before in terms of the way in which the African-American struggle has allowed itself to be co-opted and absorbed into, you know, the major party politics that always weakens us. It always weakens us. I think it's that we're at a point in terms of the next 50 to 70 years where I do think black politics is the most informed type of politics in America in terms of an oppositional politics. And if there's any group that's already, as I said earlier, primed for Donald Trump, it's like, come on, man, really, we gotta do this again? Okay, let's do it again. And I really do think it's incumbent upon parents and those of you who have no children and are single and just wanna make a difference in the community. What about adopting a school? What about adopting schools? What about a group of parents, 25 parents together, with one or two or three of you leading, adopt a school and become its resources where the school is poorly resourced. If it's well-resourced, that school doesn't need your help. But what local schools here need resources? That's something you can do. Those are lives you can change. Those are victories you can win. As opposed to, we're trying to improve education in East Bay, in Hayward. No, adopt a school. Transform the lives of those young people in that school. Watch when they're 30, when they come back to you and tell you you changed their lives. You'll know that you did the right thing. And you will also feel what we call in political science a sense of political efficacy, meaning a sense of political power. Or you feel efficacious. It's a fancy word. It's a fancy word for feeling like you know, got muscles. The sense of political empowerment and political efficacy, that is what we need. I'm convinced we need victories, small victories to build up our confidence. Small victories to build up our confidence. Obama's election was a big breakthrough, and the outcome is Donald Trump. We need local solutions to deal with these new realities, right? Because I think in the long run, we will have to organize ourselves in a way that is responsive to whatever comes. And I think at the local level, is where the real possibility is. So Edna Rose chapter of the links, Palma Ceia Baptist Church, I'm messing up the name, and all of the Hayward Historical Society, I just want to encourage you to realize that you are an important institutional presence in this community. And you may not even realize how important you are. The way you'll know, God forbid, is if you ever disappeared, you would see the sadness and the vacuum and the emptiness because no one else is trying to meet these needs. And our community has needs. People want to come together. People want to talk about what we can do. And we need to provide forums and opportunities for our communities to talk, to let people just come and talk. Open the churches, open this building for the young. Let the young people come and talk. Let them talk through their struggles. Let them talk through their difficulties. There was a killing here, I understand, in the city recently of a young man at Hayward High School. When I went over there yesterday, the students talked to me and they were telling me about how heavy this killing and incident was on all of the students, both at Hayward and at Tennyson High School. And I went there yesterday without knowing this. And I completely went there to motivate them, to hold them up, and to tell them that they needed to be positive, to never say anything negative to yourself about yourself. Do not sign up. Do not be enlisted for your own oppression. Don't sign up. They want you to sign up for your own oppression, to buy into it. Don't. What I did as a young black man, in high school, they kept taking us to prisons. They just kept taking us to the Scared Straight programs in Long Island, in New York. Took us Rahway, took us to Fishkill. I was scared to death as a young person of prison. Here I am, a grown man with an 11 and a 9-year-old son and a 6-year-old daughter. I spend my time now mostly scaring my two sons to half to death about law enforcement. And I have to realize my wife's in law enforcement. And I have to realize the trauma in my head of daily in the 80s being afraid of crack and the crack war and all that it pertained to. People talk about how hard young people got it now. Folk in the 70s and the 80s had it harder, I'm sorry. The statistics bear it out. It was easier to get killed in the 70s in the Bay Area than it is now. And anywhere else in black America in the 70s. Y'all must have forgot, as Roy Jones Jr. said in one of his raps. real quickly, to sum up, I do believe that there's an attempt to go back to an apartheid type arrangement. I think we need to be skeptical and not so humanistic and humanitarian. Stop giving everybody the benefit of the doubt. Be suspicious. If I'm wrong, then I'm wrong. But I don't trust what happened. I think that these people are literally going to try to reassert a kind of formal legal apartheid because it's already existing in every other feature of life. Housing, education, mostly jobs, employment. What part of America isn't already de facto segregated?
Right.
So all Trump is going to come in and say, let's just sign on a dotted line to confirm what we did. This happened in 1877 when we had the breakthrough for Reconstruction after 12 years from 65 to 77. It just, for the next 19 years, just chilled out. And then all of a sudden, 1896, they signed it on paper and called it Jim Crow. But it started in 1877. And they just didn't call it anything. And then one day, somebody popped up and signed it and said Jim Crow. I'm saying Donald Trump is the pop-up, and he's going to sign off on whatever has already existed in terms of racial divisions in this country. This man has hired the leading white supremacist in America, and he is, if Karl Rove were Bush's brains, then Ed Bannon is Donald Trump's Klansman. If Valerie Jarrett was Obama's advisor, that's who Ed Bannon is to him, and he's an avowed white supremacist with these stupid Neanderthalic internationalist views of how they're gonna create a fourth theory of race on the planet. This is what, you gotta Google this stuff. Following some dude named Dugin. These people really believe this stuff, like it's gonna work this time. Like Hitler, you didn't learn from Hitler that this stuff can't work. And so what I'm suggesting to us in the meantime, before they blow up the planet, meaning Trump, that we need to find ways to improve our community in an incremental and I think an elemental way where we can see marked, tangible progress, where our young people's lives are transformed. I think black folk in general need to wake up as a people and realize something significant has happened and it's not to our advantage as a national development in American history. This is a historical moment akin to the end of Reconstruction. It's akin to the white backlash to Jack Johnson becoming heavyweight champion. It's akin to the backlash with Jackie Robinson and Joe Louis. I'm sorry I'm talking about all these men, but this is the major breakthroughs other than Althea Gibson. And it's akin to Ronald Reagan and the war on drugs, as I argue in my books, the backlash to Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement. And so I'm saying we're now in another cycle, a fourth cycle, where Donald Trump is the immediate backlash to the progress that young people and people of color organized over the last 8 years politically. And so in order to, I think, go forward, parents, I think you have to be dedicated down to your last breath. That here's what I want you to hear me, please, parents. All the data is discouraging. All the numbers are discouraging, most of them. There's a lot of good data out there about signs of progress, like 85% of African Americans graduating from high school, 4 million black people in university, 2 million of all races in prison, 4 million young people black, 4 million black young people in America's universities, 2 million of every race in prison. Sadly, half of that one, that 2 million is us, and that's way too much, it's vulgar. But the good news is there are 4 million of our young people in university, and there's not a million of our young people in prison, it's a million of our people in prison of every age, so there's really good news. The black population, African Americans are not doing nearly as badly as they want you to think they do, as you are. Because I think what it does is it discourages you and it creates the self-fulfilling prophecy. But what I want to suggest is that there's a lot of reason to be hopeful, and I think parents should not be beholden to the data. I don't want to get into a debate, but this is just personal. This is not intellectual. This is personal. I just reject when I hear ADD, ADHD, all that. I just do. When I hear it, I'm like, whatever. If you're a professional out here and you know the data and the scholarship, I apologize. You can clean up after I step all over this in a second. But my view is that, you know, you have these random arbitrary assessments of our young people that say, right now, you're not paying attention, or right now, you're not where you need to be. Man, let me tell you something. I took the LSAT. Some of you all heard me say this yesterday. I failed the LSAT to get into law school. I failed the PSAT that you take before you take the SAT in high school when you're a junior. I failed the SAT. I failed the GRE to get into graduate school. I got into USC and stayed on probation for 10 years. And so this whole time I was admitted on a conditional basis. Always you're not enough. There's always something, something's missing, and you ain't quite in yet, so you got to prove yourself a little extra. And I failed happily everything they put in front of me. Happily. Because I knew it was all nonsense anyway. What will matter more for your success is what's inside you, here and here. What's in your heart and what's in your head. Man, I got a D in algebra one time with a Mr. Huron. I'll never forget this man's name, because I think if he had been right by me, I could have been an astronaut instead of a university professor. But this man wanted to make sure he shot me, cut me down before I could grow. You know how they say, I shot the sheriff, kill him before they grow? Moses and Jesus and Herod and, you know, Pharaoh, to destroy you before you grow. And so they were busy giving us these exams, and I'm telling you, young people, they will give you exams all of your life, and they're not to help you, reward you, or to place you high and put you up there with the class. It's only to say, see, this is why they're not available as a pool to hire and to bring at the prestigious universities. They give you these tests to prove, based on their assessment, where you should be on that day. Well, excuse me, but where I stand now, they have rejected me my whole life. Telling me I wasn't this, I wasn't that, I wasn't good enough to do this, I wasn't good enough to do that, but I walked away with a PhD from USC. And that may not be impressive to you if you went to Stanford or Berkeley, more power to you. But where I come from, my projects, man, please, you got to be kidding me. I told the young people yesterday, every day I wake up, I have on something with USC on, and it ain't got nothing to do with the school. It's about a little black boy who came and left his mother's home at 16 years old, came 3,000 miles across the country by himself to go to Pepperdine University, and survived, and I overcame. And I told 300 cops this about 11 months ago when I was talking to them about Black Lives Matter. I said, you all declared war on my people and my generation. And I'm here to tell you, if I die tomorrow, I won against your war. And that's what I'm here to tell you. Beat them with your success. Beat them with your greatness. Beat them because you have a sense of obligation to your community. So what I'm saying is, I was highly motivated by my mother, but I was also highly motivated by the obstacles that they put in front of me, because I felt like these were not real. They were artificial. Now, around the country, the SAT is being disregarded by universities everywhere. The AP, I grade the AP. I grade the AP exam, government and politics. Let me tell you young people here, the AP is a scam. All it is this AP, the College Board over in Jersey, coming to your school district, talking to the teacher, we're gonna train you, and you are going to train them, and they're gonna pay a bunch of money, and your school district's gonna pay a bunch of money, and we're all gonna be happy, and then you get, I kid you not. In the AP exam, a student could say Richard Nixon was a great Democratic president, and we'll get full credit for it, even though he was a Republican. I grade the AP, have been for years. These are not smart people. These ain't the best and the brightest. This is test taking. And whether or not we can get that kind of test taking here in the community, because it's a scam, the AP, it's a game. And then kids are going into university, coming in my class, and don't even know the difference between a Republican and a Democrat, but got fives on the AP. So it's a game, people. And by the time Donald Trump showed up, this game was already played. Donald Trump is not the problem. He is a symptom, yes, of a much deeper, deeper issue in this country that most people are not willing to deal with. I think I'm gonna stop here now, and thank you all for your patience with me and for your comments. So the first question I have you talk about grassroots ways to make difference by adopting a school. However, what are your suggestions for interrupting systemic oppression? And I think I would suggest a number of things. in terms of the kind of disruptions that are necessary and the kind of disruptions that we've been seeing with the Black Lives Matter movement and other local movements to confront specific people around specific things as opposed to abstract issues in the community. And so I would target specific people as opposed to, or institutions, or vulnerabilities in the local area, raise those contradictions. And I would confront it wherever it is in terms of a strategy of young people or other people coming together, making these people's lives uncomfortable. I think what I'm trying to suggest is you follow some of the tactics you've seen Black Lives Matter use, where they've gone to people's homes, they've gone to the malls, they've gone to places to make life uncomfortable for everyone, if anyone's life is going to be uncomfortable in the way that young people are confronting the issue of public state violence. And so I say confront it where it is and where you are and expose it. And I would say attack it, literally by naming it. Again, one of my students was over at Berkeley. One of my students who took African American Studies class with me is a leader of a movement there where they actually marched on the campus about 9 months ago, maybe, and kept marching and kept marching and kept making demands against the UC Regents, and they actually divested $25 million from Wells Fargo as a consequence. And this was directly from me telling my student, look, you know, confront these people where they are, and they confronted them. You have to understand, no matter how powerful somebody is, they don't want a lot of attention drawn to themselves in a negative way. Donald Trump obviously is bothered by little things. And I'm saying you have to figure out locally how to expose those sorts of circumstances where it could raise the reality of the oppressions that you address in your question. I think you have to name those oppressions, enumerate them specifically, not in general. Again, the establishment is so used, and they've come to national power with a general attitude of, we've heard all of this before, we're not interested in your complaints and your charges. Calling, you know, Breitbart racist or calling these guys racist, they've heard it all before. They're hardly moved. Calling Clarence Thomas or Uncle Tom, I'm sure that is like coffee for him now, you know? So it hardly bothers them. I think what we have to do, though, is realize you still can make people uncomfortable. And if you, whoever wrote this question, if you're serious about, you know, confronting these oppressions directly, I would say organize in a way that, again, doesn't put you in any actual danger of physical danger or arrest, at least initially. But I think it's important to confront those people, to write with the technology, with the social media young people have now at their disposal. Here's what we did. Whoever answered that question, here's my answer. In 2010, the president of my university, who's no longer there, he's gone, tried to eliminate the Upward Bound program at the University of San Francisco. It had been there for 40 years. It was a program that people on the 5 and other buses in San Francisco for years had told me they love Upward Bound because of what it had done for them. In the year of the anniversary of the Upward Bound program, of the 50th anniversary of Sergeant Shriver's promotion of the Upward Bound program, we tried to get rid of it. And we told the president no. And he told the Upward Bound program through an email, you are to be off campus soon, like next month. So we rose up against the president. Here's your answer to the oppression. He tried to put the Upward Bound program off the campus. I wish the kids weren't here, because I'd tell you exactly how I said no. I called Amos Brown from Third Baptist Church. I called the little pastor from the new AME, the AME church, a little young pastor. He's now had a stroke, sadly. But a young pastor was over there, and we brought him in from the AME church. We brought in a bunch of pastors. We got all the students together. We got staff and a few of the faculty that weren't cowards, but a lot of them were. And there were no allies. It was like very few allies. And we took about 200 black people at USF's campus and surrounded the church with a chain of people holding their hands, because I knew the visual of a bunch of black folk encircling the church. Woo! That would be a powerful visual. And I got it because I saw over at Berkeley when they had the black, they had an action they called the blackout, and they covered their mouths with black. All the students had black cloth wrapped around their mouths about 8 years ago now. This is 2010 when we followed their example. So theirs was 09. And they went to Sather Gate, and they all just sat still. The students did, and they blocked the campus at Berkeley. The Berkeley students did. So I saw that, and I said, well, we can do something like that, but we can do something. We can actually surround this church. We actually surround the church. We march up to the door, to the office of the president and the provost, the number two in power. We black faculty walked up there with the students. We moved out the students' way. We let the students walk up to the door. It looked like in the 50s when they had Governor Wallace confronted at the schoolhouse door. These students walked right up to these two powerful people and confronted them for an hour and told them that this was wrong, what they were doing, because the theme at USF is change the world from here. And we're like, well, how are you going to change the world from here? And you're trying to kick the brown people in the Upward Bound program from here. What a contradiction. That kind of attention and that kind of embarrassment and that kind of accountability is what can bring about change. Because that president had his mind made up that first day when he sent that email. A year later, we were still telling him no. We were marching. We marched on that campus for 6 months. I put it this way. When we got finished marching, USF still had its Upward Bound program. And it still does. They got rid of one part of it. It wasn't a total victory because they got rid of one part of it. But we kept the science and math, I think, triage program. Anybody familiar with Upward Bound, how it works? So we kept that part of it, the math, and that's important. But we did lose the residents. They're no longer on the campus at USF. They put them out into the city, and I resent that. But my point is, we confronted these people, and they thought it was a foregone conclusion. They're not happy that they still have to have the relationship with Upward Bound, but we forced it. And said, if you are who you say you are, as Catholics doing social justice, then there's no greater opportunity for you than to meet the needs of these young people in their educations. And then the president, the next year, when the school year opened and they talked to the faculty about all the new stuff going on, the only thing he had to say that day, after 6 months of fighting, was he is thankful that we, the faculty, fought to save Upward Bound because he realized it was actually one of the greatest assets the university had. So I told him, I said, we helped save you from you. And so that's what so to answer that question, I'm not just about talk. I wanted to tell you all this in my opening comments, that the way I got started in this thing was in 1983 when crack hit in New York. Me, my mother, and a bunch of black mothers from the projects created an organization called the United Parents Against Drug Abuse, UPADA. This is the first time I've mentioned UPADA in 30 years. But I have to remind myself, I did not get started in academia for academia's sake. I got started in this thing because I wanted to see my people be free. And I rose up against my own friends who were selling, who I was hanging out with before that, when I realized how serious crack was. And so that's how I got started, and that's how I became a professor. I became a professor because I stood up against crack in my neighborhood. So I can't relate to most academics because they all, just bookworm smart. And I'll leave it at that. Thank you, because I was about to say something I shouldn't have said. Okay, I'm going to answer these two questions shorter. Let's see here. What were the concerns of the students at Hayward High School? I didn't really get a chance to really talk to them like I wanted to, except, each student with 2 seconds and 2 minutes. But they were really attentive, as I remember, both at Hayward and Tennyson, very similar populations of students. After Tennyson, I had one young man student walk up to me, a Latino student, with almost tears in his eyes, and said, I just want to hug you. And he held me, and he wouldn't let me go. And I'm like, okay. And then he stepped back, and he just looked at me and said, I need to hug you again. And he just hugged me. And I'm just like, okay, you know what? This is beautiful. He needs this. I need this. This might be for me. It may not be for him. It might have been for me. And I'm thinking it's for him. He might have been blessing me, saying, you are reaching us or we hear you. But to answer the question, I don't want to try to speak for them. But what I heard people talk about was the shooting of this young person. And a lot of the young people were really affected by it. But I didn't probe a lot. I just tried to ask questions like, what happened? Was it gang related? That kind of thing. Even though that shouldn't even matter. A life was lost. And these young people are traumatized by it. And that's what I mean. The community has got to, I think, rally around young people in times like this and give them alternate ways of being here in Hayward. Give them some options. I know that takes money and organizing and resources, but like I said, we are a Chitlin people, and we have done well with Chitlins. They gave us Jesus. I mean, if you're a Christian in the room, they gave us Jesus all ragged and tattered up. And when, you know, the Jesus they gave us was one version, and by the time we got finished it was actually the Jesus of the Bible, the one that people believed in and taught, you know, because, you know, you give us chitlins, you give us some pig guts, we're going to make chitlins out of it. Give us your distorted teachings, and we'll show you the true example of how to treat other human beings decently. And so, again, I would say the young people just seem to be concerned about the violence. A couple of the teachers were trying to prod me to talk about instant gratification in the short lifestyle, and I tried to get to that, but it wasn't. I wasn't aware when I started that there had been violence. Somehow I missed that. My wife was Alameda County probation officer right here in Hayward, and my wife went to Cal State East Bay. So my wife might as well live over here in Hayward with y'all, but she's born and raised in Oakland. Let me get to this next question. Okay. With so many. I can't read this that well. With so many of the losing, I can't read it. I can't get that.
Yeah.
With so many
overwhelming losses.
Okay.
How do we encourage them?
Yeah.
Influence?
Okay. Thank you. With so many losses with young people, how do we encourage them? You know, I'm a history-minded person. I mean, conscious. I think history, as Malcolm said, is best qualified to reward all research. And I really do believe that we need to remind our young people of the deep cultural heritage they come from. That's what I meant by talking about the Jewish people and other ethnic populations of this country. They reiterate community, and that's what produces excellence. We want to sell out and buy into individual success. We need to think more about ourselves as a people. There are a few people in world history that have the narrative of the Black American group, and it's amazing. Beyonce's mother talks about this in Solange's. Anybody have Solange's CD? Well, the mother's talking about this. She says, our culture is just so beautiful and so rich and so deep. Man, people love everything about our culture but us. They love everything about you but you, is what one local poet in Oakland says. He said, they love everything about you but you. He said, they love the Black dance. They love the Black smile. They love the Black hat. They love the Black, you know, dial. They love everything about you but you. And he goes on and on. And that lays out our culture and the beauty of our culture and how people love the culture. It's so deep. This is going to be strange, but I taught this at Berkeley last year. The phenomena of blackface was actually a gesture of respect. Originally, from 1820 from 1820 to 1840, the Irish and Black maritime workers in Long Island, where I'm from, worked together around the waters. And during their breaks, they would sit around dancing. And the Irish and the Blacks would just start copying each other. The Blacks would do their thing, and the Irish would do their thing, and they both shared the tambourine. And as out of that, from the first 20 years, the Irish were so jealous of Black body movement that was not held back by the strictures of religion and be honestly Western culture, that they began to admire the Black body movement so much that they started painting their faces like us. Out of respect and admiration for the first 20 years, it was, wow, look at these Black folk. There's a whole scholarship that documents this. It did not start out derogatorily. The first 20 years was admiration. We want to be like you so much that we paint our faces so we can be like you. That's some deep stuff in the 1800s. It was in 1840, from 1840 to 1940, the next 100 years, that image is taken and completely distorted, and Blacks are projected as the monster of America. But originally it came out of white admiration, Irish admiration for Black body movement and Black dancing in the waterways up in what they call riverine and maritime work in Long Island, New York. Back, and again, I know this history because I'm from there, but I also taught this last semester at Berkeley in a class called African American Life and Culture. there. And we looked at the ways in which African-American culture, according to Du Bois, is largely the beginning of culture in America, outside of the native peoples who were here before all of the more recent people. So what I'm suggesting is we have to tap back into our culture. I think we need to tell our young people about the beauty of their culture. I think you need to identify the positive things in our culture that you can point to. I think you need to remind them that their people came in chains. I think you need to help them understand they came here with absolutely nothing. And now you look, and like it or not, Obama happened. And whatever else happens is irrelevant in terms of that fact. It happened, and black people in their voting made it happen. And that's what we don't know. See, we don't even know as a people that we outperformed everybody twice in 08 and 12, and we still walk around here like, we need to get ourselves together. We need to get ourselves together electorally. Well, we need a new party or something. You just outperformed everybody twice for the first time in 240 years. Do you hear me? That's who you are. And you need to tell your children who you are. Tell your children about their relatives who have accomplished things. Give them confidence in themselves by telling them you come from somebody deeper than you. That way Lil Wayne can't be their God. Lil Wayne can't be their boss. I don't want to sag too much because I don't want to show nothing. I ain't got, but you know, you get my point. It's like, if you give them culture and a healthy dose of who they are, historically, I think that is what is empowering. Again, look at the ethnic groups who excel academically in America. If you took Jews away from the white population, white performance plops. Take the Nigerians, put Nigerians in the black American category of academic performance. Guess what's gonna happen? Whop. Take the Japanese out of Asian group. Guess what happens? Whop. All this Asians on top, blacks on the bottom, white somewhere in mid is nonsense. It's specific groups amongst these groups carrying the whole group. So you walk around talking about, have you seen some folk walking around here talking about they superior? I'm like looking, no, you're not superior. You're just human like everybody else. And you're gonna leave this earth like everybody else. And so I think it's really important for our young people to build confidence and to see their own success in their community. They need positive role models and positive reinforcement from family. I constantly remind my kids how much I love them, constantly. Last year, my son Zion was at Montclair, performing well. He had been one of the top five kids all along in his kindergarten class, first, second, third grade. Then he got to third grade last year and ran into one of those teachers. And the first thing I did was I ordered Kwanzaa Kanjufu's book from the 1990s. I mean, the book is so old, they don't even publish it no more, but I got one for her anyway. A young white professor, our teacher, I took it to her, and I gave her a copy of Counting the Conspiracy to Destroy Black Boys, and I heard she didn't read it, and I didn't expect her ever to read it. I just wanted to know, I know what you're doing, and you ain't gonna get this one. You might get others, but you're not getting this one. Like Lauryn Hill says, you just lost one. I took my son out of Montclair. My son went to his own school where he is now. My son was just identified as the valedictorian, the number one of 75 students in his class. To hell with that, with what they're trying to do in terms of trying to destroy your hope and your self-confidence, because it comes down to self-confidence. When you're in class, when you're studying, when you're up there in your introductory classes at college, it's about, do I have confidence? You need confidence. And I think that's what our people need as a whole. We need to remind ourselves of who we are. We have stood down the devil practically. And still we stand. All of the sellouts, all of the people running out, talking about, oh, I'm with so-and-so, and I'm now this and that. Black, they can have you. Black people are gonna be fine without Steve Harvey. Black people are gonna be fine without Chrisette Michelle. Black people will be fine, as much as I love Jim Brown, they'll be fine without Jim Brown. Black people will be fine without whoever we produce. Because nobody we produce is more important than we. Nobody we produce is more important than we. We are more important than any one of us as a single individual, in the sense that our community has incubated all of us. And we're being asked to do something and give back. And if these young people can't rely on us to fight for them, one mother brought her two girls up to me, and I told them, I said, I know you don't know what I'm talking about. I said, but all I'm up there saying is, we're going to fight for you, and you just got to take care of your books. And that's what we need to do. We need to fight for our kids. I don't care how old you are. You 65, you tired, stop being tired. Get untired. Retired is tired again. They should call it untired. Get untired. Get back in the game, sister. You was bad before. Don't quit now. Ain't no retiring in the revolution. Ain't no tired. Ain't no retiring, sister. What can you do? Ain't no retiring, brother. What can you do? How can you sign up to serve this community? Schools need adopting, I'm hearing. Why doesn't somebody take up the idea and begin to talk about what it would mean for us to adopt one of the schools here as a community? That we loan, we give $500 so often every 6 months or something to buy, you know, buy supplies, or we do so many hours of mentoring, or so many hours of tutoring, or we bring the Historical Society's documents to the students so they can review where they're from. I'm talking about direct engagement, and the city leadership will respond, I think, to the extent that they see there's a mobilization and the energy of people here, and I think that's happening all over this country. People are stirred by these national developments, and I think it bodes a lot of possibility, a lot of positive development can come out of this. I think I have one more card, and I think that after this is almost done. I gotta put my glasses on. How do you see us tapping back into the neighborhood community feeling of the 50s and 60s prior to Brown, the Board of Education? I think at some point, just for our survival, people are going to have to find and reiterate community. And that's why I think, you know, that's one of the advantages I was saying that you had here in Hayward, is the existing community, a lot of it is intact from the 50s and the 60s. You don't have to find a new community here. All you gotta do is wake it back up to its full, I think it needs to be self-conscious of itself as a community. I think that's what we've lost, is we've lost the sense of self-conscious community, that we are deliberately trying to create community for the sake of ourselves, our peace of mind, and our children, that it's artificial, it's not natural, but we're trying to forge community. And I think by binding with any of the institutions where you know there's friendly administrators, if there's a friendly administrator, sit down with that administrator and say, how can we come up with a plan to better meet the needs of our young people in specific areas? I just think, I hope I've disabused you of big ideas and big solutions, and think more about incremental ones. I think I have one last question. Let's see here. What will be the repercussions of having Betsy DeVos as a Secretary of Education? What's your opinion of charter schools in the Black community? Wow. I think Betsy DeVos, to be honest with you, I'm not qualified to answer this question, because I honestly have just turned off of these people. Honestly, I just think it's complete sickness that Ben Carson is the head of housing. After that, I'm done. I'm serious, and I'm not trying to evade the question. I'm telling you why I don't know. I don't even care about Betsy DeVos. I know who she is. I've seen 3 minutes of hearings. This is so absurd, I won't take it seriously. It's sickness. Yes. It's sick that Ben Carson is ahead of HUD because he's Black. That is sick. Yes. Now, if they put him at the head of the Surgeon General, man, I'm jumping up and down. But I won't take her or Jim McMahon or this Ku Klux Klan, none of these people seriously. This is an absolute vulgarity and an insult to the history of this country in its best light. It's disgusting. The way in which this country is sitting back, the electorate, after this has been achieved, and we're being, as a people, shown that a white man can act any way he wants to, and he's perfectly acceptable for him to act like a you-know-what. I've been wanting to say it so bad. I've been at the Commonwealth Club about 10 times since last year. And it's usually just me and about 300 white folks sitting there together. And I keep wanting to say, ooh, Donald Trump ain't doing nothing but acting like a, and y'all letting him get away with it. Because a black man like Jesse or Al or Shirley Chisholm or a Latina or Latino or an Asian man or woman candidate would never be allowed to act like that, because that would be attached to their entire race, that bad behavior. Somehow, Donald Trump is racially innocent. So I'm not playing their sickness. I think all of this is madness. I think it's dire. I think it's dark and bleak. And that's why I think we have to work to develop locally to help our young people, to provide a canopy from all of this madness going on out there. And that's the advantage I think you all have of having your little corner here in Haywood. Unlike Oakland, has to deal with a whole bunch of stuff, San Francisco, a whole bunch of stuff, New York, these larger places with a whole bunch of stuff. You all have an existing community with a deep history and memory of at least 50 years. You know the community, you know who's who. I don't know any of them, you know all of them. Why not mobilize young folk and those veterans, mobilize around a concerted effort to make a mark here in this niche of the East Bay so that other people can see your example and try to copy it? I think that's all the questions I have. Did anybody have one out loud they wanted to ask real quick? And I'll do that and go ahead. Yes, ma'am.
Real quick, you guys, there are a lot of us involved here in Oakland, I would say Oakland Public Schools, and we have adopted schools, and they don't want our adoption.
Wow.
Wow. Whenever we say this is what's right for all kids, we get so much pushback on trying to make sure they're providing a quality education for African Americans. This is just one school.
Right.
And we think that it has to be someone connected to the school to be affected to know what that school is struggling with. But it doesn't appear to be welcome to mirror what they want.
Yeah.
And so it's a wonderful idea.
Yeah.
But what do you suggest?
No, you're right. No, you're right. It goes up against those realities. And again, I'm not qualified locally enough to really speak about how to find the vulnerabilities in the system or who the people are that you can approach. But I'm sure, you know, you and others do know there's ways of getting around these folk. And if they won't open the door, then, you know, find a rival and bless them and let them see what they could have had by adopting an alternative school. And maybe not something like adopting. That's just off the top of my head that some friends did down in Pasadena successfully. But it's just an idea. I'm just trying to think of different things that can be done in terms of collective community effort toward youth development and education in light of this crisis, as the theme of this year's whole focus of historical societies is a crisis. And I'm trying to suggest to you that we've been in crisis. For us, the crisis is the norm. And we don't get some breakthroughs where it's like, wow, this is a good time. The norm for us is the crisis of education for us is Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. And that's why you have to debrief your children and debrief your grandchildren when they come home. That's what Farrakhan says. I don't listen to a whole lot of Farrakhan, but Farrakhan says, when your kids get home, debrief them. And don't ask them, how was your day? Ask them, who had the dumbest conversation with you today? Or who said something that you just thought was interesting today? You know, ask them some weird question so they can't just say yes or no. No, he wasn't there today. No. You have to probe. Here's one other question I found. And it says, it's related to parents. It says, what is your advice to black parents in providing a good education while in public school system? I think, again, community. I think finding, for me, I tell my kids, don't believe any of this nonsense they teach you, but embrace the capacities that they offer in terms of skill sets and skill development of writing, critical thinking, analytical reasoning. Those are things that can be brought out of you by a good teacher. But in terms of the content of this stuff, man, please. I tell my kids, they don't want you to know who you really are. And they don't want to know who they really are. I'm sorry, I showed my students yesterday at San Francisco, I explained to them that the real motivation behind the civil rights movement was not Rosa Parks and that seat, but that Rosa Parks was in that seat pissed off thinking about Emmett Till, who had been killed the previous August. And she was there in December 7th, about 5 weeks earlier, that boy was killed. She was angry. That's why she didn't get up out of that seat. And they've been telling you she was tired when that same bus driver threw Rosa Parks off that bus 11 years earlier in 1944 when she was going down to investigate the rape of a sister named Recy Taylor in 1944 in Abbeville, Alabama, when Martin Luther King was about 15 years old. Rosa was a warrior. Ice Cube and all this hip hop, you know, on the Barbershop 3, they keep disrespecting her. That's because they don't know the revolutionary she was. As a young girl, she sat with her grandfather when they were funding and financing the Scottsboro Boys case in 1935. Her granddaddy, Rosa Parks, gave her a shotgun. She sat at the door with her granddaddy, who was a Marcus Garveyite. Rosa Parks is a Garveyite. That's how she was raised. And then we get this whole different narrative that she was sick and tired and sick and tired. And then all the young people who were into this intersectional stuff all of a sudden dug up this other sister named Claudette Colvin and said, oh, here's Claudette Colvin. See, the black leadership didn't want to support her because she had a baby out of wedlock. And this is the politics of respectability bullcrap, excuse me. When the reality is Rosa Parks was a real revolutionary who was going down in Abbeville in the 40s spying, and the racist who threw her off the bus in 55 threw a whole bunch of black women off the bus for years. And Rosa told him the last time, she said to him, you better not put your hand on me. She said, I know you better not touch me. So telling your children these accounts, helping your kids understand that Martin Luther King, that you shouldn't even talk to them about I Have a Dream. You shouldn't let your kids talk about I Have a Dream again. I'm serious. You need to tell your kids to start dreaming about reality on the ground and that Martin Luther King died saying he thinks he made a mistake, because that's what he said. I made a mistake. I'm integrating my people into a burning house. He told Harry Belafonte that the week before he died. I have publications of King's from after he died that he had published posthumously, where he clearly is different than I Have a Dream. Martin Luther King was a radical. Rosa was a radical. And what I'm saying to you, to parents, to answer this question, we need to tap the deep reservoir of our history and our culture and make it come alive for our young people. There are books, bookstores, online. You can get the material and expose this to your children, and I assure you the return will be confidence. And it's the confidence that they get that will make them academically more suited and capable. Again, look at those cultures in America, Jews, Indians, Armenians, the Nigerians, Japanese, ethnic groups that perform academically well in America are those groups that have a strong sense of who they are. It's the white folk in general who don't need this stuff because they are the dominant group, so they don't need it. They're the dominant group. And then there's the African-American group. And we kind of follow more that Euro model. And what I'm saying, maybe we not, for the rest of this time we got going forward, whatever's left for us as a people, maybe we need to begin to look at these other national minority populations and how they're doing it. Down the Armenians hold down Glendale. Anybody from LA? Glendale. The Armenians have Glendale held down. Kim Kardashian, her people got that whole area. It's theirs. They might as well call it Little Armenia. And there's whole areas of throughout the country where minority ethnic groups have these areas locked down. Utah, the Mormons got the whole state. And what I'm saying is, in the future, African-American people have got to figure out how to form community and solidarity is around their young people's education, and do so with a determination that we've had for our history. I am done. I am tired. Thank you all so much for your time and your attention.